Good morning. Welcome to St. Paul Christian Church's virtual worship. We are so pleased you are with us this morning, though at different places, but one faith, one Lord, one God, and one human race. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. What a beautiful day and a blessed day we are having today. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the lands. Come before his presence with singing. Serve the Lord with gladness. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thankfulness and into his courts with praise. Be grateful unto the Lord and bless his name. For the Lord is good, and his mercy and love are everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Good morning, St. Paul's. As we prepare our hearts and minds to pray for our church and our world, let us take a moment of silence to settle into our bodies, becoming ever more aware of God's presence with us. Alpha and Omega, beginning and end. Today is the Sabbath, which means it is a different day. And we begin this day set apart by sitting still with you. There is nothing we have to do to receive your love. We are fully loved and fully known, just as we are. And we are thankful. God, many of us are growing weary. The truth is we've been weary for several months, but at times it feels like too much. God, we need your strength and perseverance to continue living in this new normal. While we are thankful for the continued invitation to slow down, we miss hugs and sitting close to friends. We miss our schools and playing our favorite sports. We miss the boundaries of work and home, the villages that help us raise our children. Holy Spirit, in these moments when we grow weary, help us to pay attention to our bodies and reconnect with ourselves and our communities in life-giving ways. Give us eyes to see new life and resilient hope in unexpected places. God, we also pray for strength and perseverance for medical professionals, public health workers, our teachers and school administration, all those who are digging deep to find new reservoirs of energy, creativity, and compassion. In the same spirit, we pray for the many activists and protesters continuing to show up, speak truth to power, and advocate for liberty and justice for all. Holy Spirit, convict us when we are tempted to check out of our call to work for racial justice. Teach us how to pace ourselves so this isn't a short-term trend, but a long-term movement that cultivates real change. For all those who are weary from chemo treatments and sickness, loneliness and depression, we pray. Oh God, may we all find the Sabbath rest that we need today. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
So I was quite blessed when Jackson was little because in general he was a pretty good and laid-back kid. And what that meant is that he could stay with me in the service even when he was pretty little. So as a toddler, before he went to Worship and Wonder, Jackson would come into the service and sit with me. And the challenge that that created was what to do during communion. So I was raised in a church that not only encouraged little children to take, not only allowed little children to take communion, but really encouraged the children to participate in communion. But I also realized that there were other folks who were raised in a different tradition that had placed a lot of importance and symbolism on the first communion after baptism. So I spent a lot of time thinking and praying about what I wanted to do, and I ended up deciding that it was very important to me that Jackson take communion as we passed it around here at St. Paul's. But I was also conscious that I didn't want to influence anyone else's worship experience. So I just decided we would be inconspicuous, and we would try and, you know, I'd make sure we didn't sit on the front pew, but we would sit behind someone. And so that first Sunday after I made this decision, the bread came around, no problem. And then the cup came, and the first challenge is for a little child, it's very hard to hold on to that cup and not drink it immediately. But we survived that. He held on to the cup and he was looking and waiting. And then it was time and he got to drink the grape juice and he finished and he goes to the loudest that his little lungs could do, "Yum!" And I wanted to just fall through the floor. So much for being inconspicuous. And the great joy to me was that Susan Patterson and her boys were, you know, I was hiding behind her. And in the middle of my, you know, being mortified, I realized that Susan Patterson and her boys were starting to giggle. And I thought, it's going to take so much more than that for me to upset Susan Patterson, thank goodness. And in that sort of moment of relaxation, God hit me over the head with a 2x4 and said, you know, Jackson's physical enthusiasm at drinking that grape juice is what I want you to be doing spiritually. Communion, we are remembering and taking part of the most fabulous gift that God could have given us. The gift of grace and forgiveness and his son, death and resurrection on the cross. And even though we approach this time with reverence and sincerity, spiritually, this is an opportunity for us to enjoy the magnificence of that forgiveness and just yell, "Yum!" from our very being. So I invite you to come with me today and prepare for communion. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to this table in a time of undeniable personal anxiety, in the midst of total social chaos and fear. And yet, steadfastly and calmly, you call us to this table to physically and spiritually participate in the gift of your unending and unstoppable grace. You call us to consume your forgiveness and your unending love, precious gifts bought through the crucifixion on the cross and the resurrection into new life of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. As we eat and drink in this amazing gift, may our hearts truly rejoice and say with childlike joy and innocence, "Yum," with an enthusiasm that blesses and uplifts not just ourselves, but those physically around us and within millions of miles. Let us come together and partake. Amen.
Gathered for a special Passover feast with his disciples, we remember that Jesus took the bread that was on the table and blessed it and broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Every time you eat this bread, do it with joy in remembrance of me." Then Jesus also took the cup and said, "This is a new covenant poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink this cup, remember that my love flows through you." And now with thanks for these gifts, let us pray a prayer of thanksgiving together. With gratitude for your generous gifts, God, we turn now from receiving to giving. Moved by your example, motivated by your love, empowered by your belief in us that we are your disciples, enable us to live lives worthy of your calling. We pause now for a moment of silence to offer you our best intentions to serve you wholeheartedly, to offer you our gifts of money and time and prayer, of song and praise, trusting that you will use all we offer to build your kingdom among us. Let us offer our gifts in silence to God. Amen. As Christians, the words of Jesus are deeply meaningful to us. Even though 2,000 years later, we can't be completely sure that the words that are attributed to Jesus in the Bible are direct quotes, we still place special importance on those phrases that have been passed down generation to generation and recorded as the words of Christ. Some Bibles even print those words in red to emphasize their power. I wonder what some of your favorite sayings of Jesus are. If you can think of them off the top of your head, I invite you to put them in the comments and share them with others. It might be things like, love your neighbor as yourself. Do not fear or do not worry. Maybe your favorites are the words of the Lord's Prayer or those words spoken at the Last Supper, which we just repeated around the table. Our favorites are often the words that bring us comfort, the words that remind us that we are loved and forgiven, that we belong. But Jesus also spoke words of challenge. Sometimes he said mysterious or strange things that leave us confused. Instructions that we would rather ignore. Things like love your enemy, turn the other cheek. Some of Jesus' words are so familiar to us that they have lost their power to shock us or to motivate us in the way that Jesus probably intended. Over the next 6 weeks, we're going to examine a few of Jesus' more unsettling statements and try to figure out what they mean for us as modern disciples. We begin today with a passage from Matthew 13, verses 44 to 52. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. Throw them into the furnace of fire. Harsh words from the Savior who promises us unconditional love and forgiveness at the communion table. The same host whose gracious welcome Amanda reminded us of last week for all. And so how do we reconcile a Christ of grace and mercy with these words of judgment? This speech about sorting out the good from the bad also paints a dualistic picture of morality. You are either good or bad, evil or righteous, when most of us probably fall somewhere in between those extremes. And throughout his own ministry, Jesus seems to recognize this more complex range of human behavior. Though tax collectors may have extorted money from people, Jesus reminds us that they still have the potential to be generous. Even though a woman has committed adultery, Jesus reminds us that she should not be condemned. After all, those who accuse her have also made their own mistakes. Even though Peter's faith wavers, he is still the rock on which Jesus proclaims his church will be built. Jesus has a reputation for eating with people who are known sinners, and he even promises the thief on the cross next to him a place in heaven, which shows that it is never too late to be redeemed. So knowing this, what do we make of these fiery words in Matthew? Words that also come up in several other places in the Gospels too. In spite of how these words sound to our ears, I believe that Jesus here is meaning to offer comfort, not to provoke fear. For those of us with very little personal experience of evil, who haven't had to suffer for our faith or endure violent oppression, we tend to be more comfortable with the Jesus who promises peace, who doesn't rock the boat. But for people who have witnessed evil firsthand, for those who have been on the receiving end of injustice, a Jesus who turns the tables and assures us that the first will be last and the last will be first, that cruelty has no place in God's kingdom. This is the Savior they have been waiting for. Just before this line, Jesus has been telling all kinds of parables about the kingdom of heaven, reminding us of the coming realm in which the current order of things will be turned upside down. This was a message to people who were living under the weight of Roman rule. And it's still a powerful message today for people who struggle under the weight of racism and prejudice, for Montagnard people in Vietnam who face torture and theft from the government, for survivors of abuse. Jesus tells us that another way is possible, in which the wicked do not win, in which the powers that permit and perpetuate evil are held accountable, in which God's love and mercy reigns for all. And anything that gets in the way of God's love and mercy will be cast out. Jesus is telling us that evil is temporary. Only what is truly good, what is truly of God, will endure in the end. And so these words provide hope for people desperately longing for a new way of life, for a new kind of society, a kingdom which would be worth giving up everything else to find. Reverend Talitha Arnold says that what Jesus is doing here is transforming human life, not by scaring the hell out of people, but by helping them see the heaven close at hand. The bad in the world is not part of God's intention. God intends a world in which good flourishes. And so we are encouraged, just like the merchant and the tenant in these parables, to commit ourselves to what God values. To be sure that we are aligning ourselves with the values of God's realm, instead of the oppressive forces working against God's purposes. And so this is where there is no room for in-between, where we must be all in or cast out. We cannot be bystanders in bringing about God's kingdom. Once we have glimpsed the treasure that God promises us, we have to choose to respond with our whole hearts, to let go of anything else that gets in the way of being a part of God's kingdom. And so even though it is God who judges at the end, not us, we are not meant to be passive in the face of injustice. A little over a week ago, the world lost a great civil rights hero, John Lewis. Lewis, who was also a Baptist minister, spent his whole life working to cast out injustice from the world, often at great risk to himself. He was badly beaten many times, most famously on the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama, while marching for voting rights with Martin Luther King Jr. Over and over, as Lewis joined the Freedom Riders on integrated buses and at sit-ins, at lunch counters, he encountered the forces of evil and hatred. And yet, he also knew the deep power of forgiveness ingrained in him by his faith. I read that one day in 2009, a man showed up at Lewis's congressional office in D.C., and the man confessed to Lewis that he had been in the KKK and was one of the people who had severely beaten Lewis in an incident on a bus decades before. He said, "I want to apologize. Will you accept my apology?" And Lewis forgave the man, hugged him, and they cried together. We can believe in a God of grace and forgiveness while still refusing to give our hearts to the things in the world that are evil, the things that draw us away from the life that God intends for all. Let us, too, be willing to commit ourselves fully to the life-changing treasure that Jesus has shown us, and cast out all else that would keep us from knowing the true joy of sharing in Christ's love and kingdom. If you are longing to be a part of a community that seeks to learn and grow about Jesus together, then we'd be happy for you to talk to us anytime about joining our church here at St. Paul's. You can reach out to me or to Amanda, and if you want us to contact you, fill out the attendance card that is linked on this video. Let us join together in song of God's coming kingdom.
Thank you.
It has been a joy to worship with you this morning. We continue to thank you for your patience and grace as we've learned so many new things over the past month about live streaming. There are a couple of ways that you could help us out as we're making this transition. One is that we are looking for new or used iPads that maybe came out in the past like 2 years that have good camera technology that would help us continue to improve our picture and the quality of live stream that we're able to offer to you. The other is that we're looking for a couple of folks who would be willing to help serve on our live stream tech team, 3 to 4 volunteers who'd be willing to be here on Sunday mornings and help us put together the service. Even if you've never live streamed before, but you are confident in working with a computer, that is more than enough. And we could definitely train you on the things that you need to know to help us in those areas. So if you can help us in either of those ways, with an iPad donation or by serving on our tech team, please let Diane or I know, and we will be happy to figure out the best way to get those resources in our live stream worship. A couple of other exciting announcements happening in our community this week. This Wednesday at 7 p.m. on Zoom, we will be having our third Walk the Talk session. Walk the Talk has been a place for us to learn and reflect and take action for racial justice in our community. So this Wednesday, we will have space for reflection and conversation as we check in with our bodies and emotions and talk about strategies to make sure we can engage in this work long term. So this Wednesday, 7 p.m. on Zoom, even if you haven't attended any of our other Walk the Talk events before, anyone is welcome to hop in at any time and be a part of the conversation. This Thursday, middle and high school youth are invited to a trip to Farm Church in Durham. We're going to be working in their garden and just learning about their vision of what church looks like and what church can be. So we will meet at Farm Church at 4:30 on Thursday. Let me know if folks need a ride. We're trying to all ride with our family units, but some exceptions can be made if needed. So feel free to reach out to me, RSVP, if your youth can attend with us this Thursday. A reminder that next Sunday is the first Sunday of a new month, believe it or not. So we will be collecting our groceries and canned goods, non-perishables, for Urban Ministries here in Raleigh. So you can drop off any of those donations throughout the week or next Sunday, and Tom Law or another volunteer will be taking those to Urban Ministries. So we really thank you for those donations. There are a ton of families right now who appreciate that extra support. And last but certainly not least, next Sunday evening, August 2nd at 6 p.m., we will have another Sunday night outdoor fellowship opportunity. We will gather under the oak tree for some music, including a performance from our Montagnard community and a blessing of backpacks and devices for our kids who are planning on going back to school. Our children will also have the opportunity to pack hygiene kits for Church World Service and play some fun socially distanced games. So we hope you will join us next Sunday evening. As we conclude our worship service this morning, I invite you to join me in the benediction that you will see on your screen. I will be reading the non-bold section, and we will read the bold together. Let us go with Christ's word written on our hearts. May Christ's words of comfort keep us from despair. May Christ's words of challenge keep us from complacency. May Christ's unfailing love keep us close until we meet again. Amen.